Then you replenish the remaining starter by feeding it with more flour. Then you can use it for the next batch of dough, and so on. A starter is actually alive and will keep for years as long as you give it an occasional feed. Chef Nancy Silverstone has generously shared some of her very personal secrets of baking.
I'm going to show you a sourdough starter that produces what I think is the best bread of all. This is a starter that's made with grapes, water, and flour. The grapes provide the food source for the wild yeast in the air and in the flour grains themselves to feed off of and live and multiply. What you need to do is you need to tie up a pound of grapes and some cheesecloth, and then you need to bash it around a little to release some of the juices, which see that I'm doing. Get your aggressions out a little, right? Okay, and we're going to mix up a slurry of some flour and water. And then submerge the grapes into this mixture. And this is where these grapes are going to live for the next week, hopefully, in a place of honor in your kitchen. Submerge the grapes into the flour and water mixture, cover it, and leave it at room temperature for a week. I want to show you what you're going to see throughout the week as your grape, water, and flour mixture takes on life of its own. You know, the first time I made a starter, what I did is I let it go for a couple days. I'd look at it, I'd smell it. It smelled awful, it looked awful, and I'd throw it away. And I did this a few times until I finally had the patience to let the starter run the course of the week and be able to come up with the bread that I'm making now. After the first 2 days, what happens is there's a slight separation. The alcohol from the fermentation rises to the top. It starts to take on a very slightly sour flavor. The bag is still inflated that contained the grapes. Much activity, as you can see. By the fourth day, you know, just 2 days later, you can see a huge change in this mixture. The smell is starting to smell very, very cheese-like almost, kind of not too pleasant. You see a lot of bubbling activity. The bag of grapes have deflated, and the flavor of the flour, of the sour is much stronger than it was earlier on. At this point, you could make bread from this, but I feel it's best to let it go another 3 or 4 days to really develop a strong, strong sour characteristic. And by the sixth day, great changes have taken place. My bag full of grapes is completely deflated. The color of the grapes have oozed into the starter itself. I have a separation between the alcohol fermentation and the density of the flour. The smell is strong. The taste is strong and I find quite delicious. However, it's hungry. This mixture is alive. It hasn't eaten for 6 days. It needs flour. Let me show you how to feed your starter. You need to discard and squeeze out the grapes. And here in front of me, I have the starter minus the grapes and my food, water, and flour. Incorporate the flour and water into your starter. Cover it and put it in a warm place in your kitchen. And in about 8 to 10 hours, your starter will be active and healthy and bubbly and ready to be turned into a loaf of bread. For the rustic dough, I have my bread flour in the food processor, and to it I'm going to add my healthy sourdough starter and a little bit of already activated yeast. And with the machine running, I'm going to be adding my water and milk, olive oil, and lastly, the salt. I'll be processing this for about a minute after the dough actually comes together in a ball around the center. this is a good point to stop and have a look at your dough, acquaint yourself with the way that it, the way that it feels. Notice how sticky this dough really is and should be. Also, taste it. Make sure you remember all your ingredients, your salt, your olive oil, your milk. We're going to let this sit for about 5 minutes so the flour can absorb the excess water and then reprocess it to finish the kneading process. Now I've transferred my dough to a well-oiled bowl. I'm going to be covering it with plastic and letting it rise for about 2 hours to develop both its flavor, its texture, and the growth that it needs. Over here I have a dough that I've already let gone through that rising process or fermenting process. You can see the beautiful network I have as I peel off the plastic. You can just imagine when this dough is baked, when you slice into it, the wonderful hole structure that it will have. There we go. Now I'm going to be doing two things with this dough. I'm going to be making the loaf itself and also the focaccia, so it's necessary for me to divide the dough in half. So if you are going to do the same thing as I am, make sure you put it onto a very well floured board. Go flour over the top. Stretch the dough out a little. I'm going to be transferring our rustic loaf to a piece of parchment paper that is heavily dusted with flour and semolina or finely ground cornmeal. Make sure you have a lot of flour, well flour underneath. Lift up the angles and simply scoop and lay it out. Reform it a little, and then we're going to be covering it with a linen and letting it proof again the final time for 2 hours. Now that my dough has risen for about 2 hours, it's ready to go in the oven baked. If you feel it, which is a very important step in bread baking, you can feel that it's expanded as far as it's going to. That's something that's hard to communicate by words, but once you've done it over and over again, you'll definitely know what I'm talking about. Top of the bread needs to be lightly floured again with a little flour and a sprinkling of the semolina. And we're going to invert it onto another piece of parchment paper. A little tricky, but works every time. Okay, so slip the peel onto it. We're going to actually bake the loaf of bread directly on the parchment paper, which we'll be removing later. Dimple the surface. And now the bread is ready to go in the oven. My oven's been heating the last hour at 500 degrees. It already has a ceramic tile in it, and this ceramic tile captures the heat and provides a bread that has a very, very crisp crust. I'm also going to be spritzing the oven. Allowing the bread to cook in a moist environment prevents any crust from forming on the bread immediately, and then the bread can rise and cook and have a very nice oven spring. Spritz the back and the sides of the oven. Close it so that you trap the moisture. Slip the bread into the oven and close it again. You need to repeat the spritzing process a few times over the next 10 minutes. It's been 30 minutes now, and I'm going to take the bread out of the oven and invert it. Discarding the paper, this ensures that the bread covers evenly on both sides. It's been about 40 minutes and the bread should be done. So far, the first test in whether a bread is done is happening right now, and that's the smell in the air. The second test is always the color of the crust. And let's have a look here. It's a beautiful brown color. and that passed the test. And the third test is to listen to the sound when you knock it on the bottom. That thud, hear that thud, that hollow sound, ensures that the bread is baked all the way through. This is something I wouldn't nearly do, but I'm going to cut a slice of this very hot bread so you can see the texture that this bread provides. This is truly one of my favorite breads. Look at the texture in the crumb of this bread, the large holes, the irregularity. It's really just a really sensual bread.
Flat, puffy, and roughly rectangular, this unusual rustic loaf is easy to serve. Just break a piece off and serve it with soups and salads.